Our next speaker is no stranger to spring at all. Brother Bruce Stulting was born and raised in Carnes City, Texas, and he graduated from the Southwest School of Bible Studies back in 1989. That's where I got to know him somewhat. I got to know him a lot better and know his good wife, not the bad wife, the good wife. And sometimes she...
Well,
that's what I wanted him to say that. I wasn't going to say that. Anyway, I've known Bruce from the standpoint of his dedication to the truth, his willingness to sacrifice the cause of Christ. And they have known a tremendous amount of hurt and sacrifice and proven through all of those bad days to be dedicated to our Lord. The affairs of this world would not move them from their dedication to the truth, no matter how much the sorrow was. And one reason is because of the sentiments of that song we just sang, which is very important to all of us loving the Lord. He did work at the Memphis School of Preaching and Studies in 1998 and 2000. And he's done local work in Kansas and Missouri and Arkansas. And now he's been at the Fish Hatchery Road Congregation, Huntsville, since 2001. He serves there also as one of the elders. He's done mission work in the Philippines and Cambodia, preaches in gospel meetings and several lectureships, has conducted evangelistic campaigns in Kansas and Missouri, and worked in numerous Bible youth camps, served as a faculty on the Rose Hill Bible Learning Center in Little Rock, that's in Arkansas, and currently serves as an instructor when we have it up and going in Truth Bible Institute. And he does secular work, tent maker at the Texas Department of Transportation. And you'll be hearing from him shortly as to, I think that's what I got from him the other day, about him directing the Lone Star Bible Camp that'll come up here before we know it. So we appreciate his work there and appreciate him as a gospel preacher and a defender of the truth. Brother Bruce, come speak to us.
Sorry. Yeah, that's a wake-up call. Appreciate the kind words, introduction. I do have a strong love for this congregation, built over many years of working on various things with the brethren here, not the least of which is Lone Star Bible Camp. The members here have been invaluable help in the staffing and preparations and getting things together so we can have that camp. It is just a great opportunity for our children to get together with other Christians who love the Lord, love the Bible, that we can get together and study the Word and build up our children in the most holy faith. It's a good work, and I appreciate all the help that I receive. In fact, I always tell my staff that their job is to make me look good, and they do it every year. It's a hard job for them to make me look good. Thank you, Michael. The fact is, I couldn't do what I do without the staff and without the kids. If you have children, 8 to 18, high school age, send them to our camp. We'd be glad to have them. And we've had kids from all over the country. We've even had some that registered from other countries but weren't able to attend. Hopefully that'll work out this year that they'll be able to be here. But pray for that effort. It is a worthy effort, and we certainly appreciate everyone involved. Fatal error on the Holy Spirit as it relates to the false doctrine of irresistible grace. Irresistible grace is part of a fourth of a five-part theology relating to salvation known as Calvinism. The name is derived from John Calvin, who popularized this doctrine during the Protestant Reformation. For those unfamiliar with the 5 points of Calvinism, we have them listed, 1 through 5, total depravity, also known as total inability. Man has sunk so far through the fall that he is no longer capable of believing the gospel. He can no more repent and believe than a dead man can rise up and walk. This is all the result of the sin of Adam, who communicated this total depravity, or in other words, the loss of free will, to all of his posterity, all of his descendants. That would include us living today. The second tenet of Calvinism, unconditional election. God has, before the foundation of the world, selected a portion of humanity to be saved. This election is irresistible, or irrespective, rather, of any foreseen merits or faith. It is only according to the good pleasure of God's will. In other words, it's an arbitrary selection. Some are going to be saved and some will be lost. Then we have limited atonement, the third tenet, also known as particular redemption. Jesus on Calvary bore the full punishment due his elect, ensuring their final salvation. He did not die for the non-elect who are excluded and helplessly reprobate. So he only died for those that God has predestined to salvation. Then we have the fourth tenet, irresistible grace, the topic of our study today, also known as efficacious grace. God moves upon the helpless sinner before he has a single thought of responding to the gospel. Grace renews man's spiritually dead will, imparts a new nature, and infallibly draws the sinner to Christ. It goes on, regeneration or the new birth occurs before belief in Christ. Faith, in fact, it says, is a gift imparted to the sinner who is entirely passive in the act. And then number five, perseverance of the saints, also known as final perseverance. Everyone regenerated by God's grace will persevere and be finally saved. No one who truly begins the life of faith will ever fall away and perish. Thus, it's impossible for the elect to so sin as to be eternally lost. Now, that's the five tenets of Calvinism. Now, all of these tenets rise or fall, stand or fall, on the very first one, total depravity. If that's true, then the corollary, according to the Calvinists, is that each one of these must follow. In fact, they're very proud of what they perceive as a very consistent doctrine. And so really, if you want to defeat Calvinism in these 5 points, the battleground has to be on total depravity. If you can show that that is false, then all of the rest is just really not necessary. Now, irresistible grace, of course, is the idea that the elect, those who Calvinists believe have been unconditionally elected to eternal life, cannot resist the grace of God. The elect cannot resist. When the Holy Spirit comes upon them, they're going to be saved whether they want to or not. Regardless of what they or how their life is, regardless of whether they desire to repent or whatever. God's grace and Christ's atonement are not extended to those who are predestined to be lost. Now, there's a lot of things wrong with this doctrine that we're not going to be able to cover. Okay? When we talk about all five tenets, it would be nice if we could study all five and then get down to their irresistible grace. But we just don't have time for that. So we're going to study irresistible grace. On the other hand, it says the grace of God overwhelms the elect in such a way that even if they wanted to, they could not resist. And so we're going to examine this fourth tenet of Calvinism, irresistible grace, by viewing how Calvinists themselves express this doctrine. We're going to look at some of the texts that they use to support this, and then we're going to come back and look at some scriptural objections to this doctrine. So let's look at how they explain it, their own self. John Calvin believed that only a direct operation of the Holy Spirit could make one who is dead in sin hear the gospel and believe. This means that the gospel would not be sufficient to convict and convert the heart of the sinner. Calvinists say the Lord, through the Spirit, must appear to the sinner in a direct, miraculous way in order to bring about the sinner's conversion. And if the sinner is one whom God had predestined to life before the foundation of the world, the sinner must submit to God's grace as revealed to him by the Spirit. We think about this idea. We look at the Westminster Confession of Faith, expresses this doctrine by saying, all those whom God had predestined unto life, and those only he is pleased in his appointed and accepted time, effectually to call by his word and Spirit out of the state of sin, sin and death in which they are by nature, to grace and salvation by Jesus Christ, enlightening their mind spiritually and savingly to understand the things that God taken away their heart of stone and given unto them a heart of flesh, renewing their wills, and by his almighty power determining them to that which is good, and effectually drawing them to Jesus, yet so as they come most freely, being made willing by his grace. That's chapter 10, section 1, the Westminster Confession of Faith. David N. Steele and Curtis C. Thomas, in their book, The 5 Points of Calvinism, Defined, Defended, and Documented, say the gospel. Now, this is interesting. A lot of people that have a cursory knowledge of Calvinism really don't know how that the Calvinists get there. And this is, I thought, was really telling on their doctrine. It said the gospel invitation extends a call to a salvation to everyone who hears its message. It invites all men without distinction to drink freely of the water of life and live. It promises salvation to all who repent and believe. But this outward general call extended to the elect and non-elect alike. In other words, God's inviting everybody. The offer of salvation is open to everyone, and it's extended to the elect and non-elect alike. It says, will not bring sinners to Christ. And he asks the question, why? Because men are by nature dead in sin and are under its power. They are of themselves unable and unwilling to forsake their evil ways and to turn to Christ for mercy. Consequently, the unregenerated will not respond to the gospel call to repentance and faith. No amount of external threatening or promises will cause blind, deaf, dead, rebellious sinners to bow before Christ as Lord and to look to him alone for salvation. Such an act of faith and submission is contrary to lost man's nature. Therefore, he says, the Holy Spirit, in order to bring God's elect to salvation, extends to them a special call in addition to the outward call contained in the gospel message. Through this special call, the Holy Spirit performs a work of grace within the sinner, which inevitably brings him to faith in Christ. He further says, although the general outward call of the gospel can be and often is rejected, the special inward call of the Spirit never fails to result in the conversion of those to whom it is made. This special call is made to all sinners, but is issued to the elect only. The Spirit is in no way dependent upon the help or cooperation for success of his work of bringing them to Christ. It is for this reason that Calvinists speak of the Spirit's call and of God's grace in saving sinners as being efficacious, invincible, and irresistible. For the grace which the Holy Spirit extends to the elect cannot be thwarted or refused. It never fails to bring them to true faith in Christ. Now, I want to summarize. I want you to really, that's a lot of reading, a lot to absorb, but I want to summarize what that says so we can understand it. Number one, the gospel call is extended to everyone, elect and non-elect alike. Everybody gets to hear the gospel. Everybody gets to hear the plan of salvation. Everybody gets to understand that salvation is possible. Because of his depravity, man cannot answer the call of the gospel, even if he so desired. Number three, a special inward call of the Holy Spirit in addition to the outward call of the gospel is necessary. So now we have two calls. All right? Number four, through this special call, the Spirit performs a special working of grace, which inevitably brings the sinner to faith in Christ. Number five, the special inward call is not offered to all sinners, but only to the elect. Number six, the inward call of the Spirit cannot be resisted. Number seven, the Spirit is in no way dependent on the help or cooperation for success in his work of bringing the sinner to Christ. In other words, he's going to do it to you directly, irresistibly, whether you want it or not. Regardless of what your life is like, you could be the most rank sinner, but if you're one of those that are predestined to salvation, you're going to be saved. And that's not anything you can do about it or say about it. It's just going to happen. Now let's look at some texts. Again, time constraints will not allow us to look at all the texts that they use to support their doctrine. We'll look at some as we have opportunity. Acts chapter 16, verse 14. Acts chapter 16, verse 14. It says, And a certain woman named Lydia, a seller of purple, the city of Thyatira, which worshiped God, heard us, whose heart the Lord opened, that she attended unto the things which were spoken of Paul. Now, according to the Calvinists, it was necessary for God to open Lydia's heart in order for her to receive the word. Once her depraved heart was opened, she then heard the word and was saved. However, the context just doesn't support this. In fact, the Calvinist has things slightly out of order. Now, consider the proper order of events leading up to Lydia's conversion. Number one, Lydia started out as a worshiper of God, verses 13 and 14. Number two, after she heard the preaching of Paul, Silas, and Timothy, her heart was open. That was a result of their preaching. Not something God did directly. They preached to her. Her heart was open. Number three, she responded by obeying the Lord, verse 15. It's interesting to note that Calvinists will use this passage as proof text for irresistible grace, but they'll exclude the part where she was baptized, where she was obedient. You say, passages that speak of God changing a man's heart or in giving him a new one do not necessarily teach Calvinist doctrine. It's not uncommon for the scriptures to speak of a man's inability to do things without divine influence, yet this doesn't make man wholly passive in the doing of those things. For example, Psalm 127 and verse 1. We read, except the Lord build the house, they that labor in vain that build it, except the Lord keep the city, the watchman waketh but in vain. Now, Solomon's not saying here that man is wholly passive in building the house unless God comes and changes his heart and makes him into a master carpenter. It's not what he's saying there. That if the man's going to build the house to be successful, he has to include the Lord. That's all it means. Lord does his part, blessing the work. Man does his part by doing the work. It's the same thing as a farmer praying for rain so this crop will grow. He goes, that doesn't mean that he's going to have to wait around for God to give him some special blessing of grace to enable him to plant the crop, till the land, harvest the crop, grind the wheat, make the flour so his wife can bake the bread. You see, but man working together with God gets the job done. This is always using a figure of speech conveying man's dependence upon God in all things. No one would think of contriving some doctrine that man is dead to building a house or guarding a city unless he's somehow miraculously enabled by God. Man needs to incline his heart toward God and righteousness. The Bible often speaks of God changing the heart of man. At other times, the Bible teaches that man that there is something that man must do in order to change his own heart. Both things are true. One text is looking at conversion from the divine perspective. The other verses are looking at it from the human perspective. The Calvinists may think they find support in passages like Deuteronomy 30 and verse 6. Notice what it says. And the Lord thy God will circumcise thy heart and the heart of thy seed to love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, and all thy thou mayest live. Now, notice what Jeremiah says, chapter 4 and verse 4. He says, circumcise yourselves to the Lord. Now, wait a minute. If we go back to Deuteronomy, doesn't it say the Lord's going to circumcise their heart? Is Jeremiah asking something that's unreasonable, impossible, when he says, circumcise your own hearts to the Lord? No. These passages are in perfect harmony. There's that which the Lord does for man, and that's what those things which man does for himself. There's no contradiction here. Nor is there any hope or help for the Calvinist and saying, see, the Lord has to circumcise your heart. No, man circumcises his own heart. And the Lord blesses him when he does. Our text speaks from the divine side and from the human side. According to the psalmist, accordingly, the psalmist asks that God might incline his ear toward keeping the commandments, Psalm 119 and verse 36. Later on, in verse 112, in the same psalm, the writer says that he had inclined his own heart. Now, wait a minute. Which is it? Is it the Lord inclining his heart, or did he incline his own heart? No. Again, we have the divine side and we have the human side. It's that simple. And that's in the same psalm. Neither statement was intended to formulate a tenet of theology. There are simply two perspectives on the same subject. Now, Romans chapter 8 and verse 7. It says, because the carnal mind is enmity against God, for it is not subject to the law of God, neither indeed can be. So the Calvinist believes that the carnal mind possessed by those who are depraved cannot understand, believe, or obey the spiritual law of God. They conclude that the special inward call of the Holy Spirit is necessary for the sinner to understand and respond to the gospel call. This view is proved false when one considers the context of Romans chapter 8, verses 1 through 8. In the context, Paul is actually discussing the will of man, the free will of man, who chooses whether or not to follow the gospel. He contrasts two groups of people, those who are spiritual-minded and those who are carnal-minded. The spiritual-minded are interested in spiritual things. The carnal-minded are interested in carnal things. But it's the spiritual-minded man that's interested in spiritual things. However, those who are carnal-minded possess no interest in spiritual matters and will be disobedient. There is no hint of a special call of the Holy Spirit in these passages. God does not force anyone to accept his will. Yet Calvinists view people as some type of robot that's destined to automatically follow a predetermined sequence of events or operations or respond to encoded instructions with no will of his own. God effectually calls only the elect by the gospel. But since man is corrupt by nature, having inherited his corruption from Adam, he is unable to come to God. That's what the Calvinists want us to believe. Thus, a supernatural operation is necessary in order to enable the elect to understand the gospel. Now, let's look at some objections. Running out of time, so we've got to look at some objections and move on. Irresistible grace contradicts the scriptural principle of free agency. Uh-oh, we're under attack. I know that's not my wife's phone because I know her ringtone. This tenet of Calvinism declares that the grace of God cannot be rejected. In contrast, the Bible plainly teaches that one's salvation is conditional on his own acceptance of the gospel and obedience. Furthermore, the Bible teaches that one can either reject or accept salvation as is offered through Christ Jesus. The grace of God has appeared unto all people, all men, Titus 2 and verse 11. And yet millions have rejected it, Romans 10 and verse 16. Not all have obeyed the gospel. Imagine that. Each person is accountable for his response to the gospel. Jesus warns, he says, and if any man hear my words and believe them not, I judge him not, for I come not to judge the world, but to save the world. He that rejects me and receives not my words has one that judges him. The word that I spoke, have spoken, the same shall judge him in that day. John 12, verse 47 and 48. Notice, Jesus is saying you have a right, an option, an ability to receive his words. And there's consequences if you do not. Now, those who reject the teaching of Jesus Christ are held accountable. Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that hears my words and believes them not, he that hears my words and believes on him that sent me has eternal life. See, we can reject it and be condemned. We can accept it and be rejected. John 5, verse 24, and chapter 8, and verse 24. The Bible says, or states, that each individual is free to choose whether or not to take advantage of the grace of God. It's clearly demonstrated that one may resist God's grace as revealed in his word. Stephen understood that the Holy Spirit could be resisted. Consider his statement to the unbelieving Jews. He says, you stiff-necked, uncircumcised, and hard in ears, you do always resist the Holy Ghost. Now, their whole point is that the Holy Ghost is irresistible. He's effective every time. But Stephen says, you do always resist the Holy Ghost as your fathers did, so do ye, Acts 7 in verse 51. God punishes those who resist his power. How, therefore, resist the power of God? Resist the ordinance of God? And they that resist shall receive in themselves damnation. Romans 13 in verse 2. And so it's possible to resist the Holy Spirit, resist God's will, and there's punishment awaiting those that do. Irresistible grace mistakenly portrays how God calls people to salvation. All people are called through the gospel, 2 Thessalonians chapter 2 and verse 14, not through some irresistible working of the Holy Spirit. The Bible does not say that people are called by some still small voice or by a direct operation of the Holy Spirit on them in conversion and conviction. The Holy Spirit does not work apart from the Word. We've said this repeatedly in this lectureship. That's how the Holy Spirit works, through the Word. You know, it's interesting to contrast Mac Deaver's doctrine with Calvinistic doctrine. Calvinism, and I think it was mentioned yesterday, that Mac holds the position that after salvation, then you're unable to obey the will of God. You need help from the Holy Spirit. The Calvinists, on the other hand, have the idea that without the help of the Holy Spirit, you can't obey the gospel. So they have you depraved before. Mac has you depraved after. It's post-salvation depravity is what Mac... See, they have pre-salvation depravity. Mac has post-salvation depravity. Now, that's a sad position to be in. Furthermore, Mac would have you believe... See, the Calvinists believe you can't do anything without the help of the Holy Spirit. Once you have that help of the Holy Spirit, you can do anything. Now, Mac has a similar idea. Man, as a Christian, you can do all you can to resist sin, and then when you can't do any more, the Holy Spirit takes up and does the rest. He helps you beyond what you can help yourself. Now, what happens then if I resist all I can, the Holy Spirit does his part, and I give it to temptation anyway? Whose fault is it? What happened to the help of the Holy Spirit then? Did he let me down? Is that possible? Remember, I'm doing all I can to resist sin. Then the Holy Spirit does for me that which I can't do for myself, and I sin anyway. Whose fault is it? In conversion and sanctification, the Holy Spirit does not work apart from the Word. It goes on in Romans 1 and verse 16. Paul says, I'm not ashamed of the gospel, for it's the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believes, the Jew first, also to the Greek. Calvinist does not believe that the gospel alone is sufficient to save the sinner. Thus, they are ashamed of the gospel. Irresistible grace misuses the new birth and conversion. Jesus spoke of being born again in John chapter 3. Speaking of Nicodemus, he said, Verily, verily, I say unto you, except a man be born again, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. Verse 3. Calvinists will take this to mean that man is as passive in the new birth as an infant is in the literal birth. But figures of speech should not be pressed into the service of theology in this way. He's using an illustration to explain how one enters the kingdom. The context of John chapter 3 indicates that man is not passive in the new birth. In verse 5, still on the subject, Jesus says, Verily I say unto you, except a man be born of water and spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of heaven or kingdom of God. Evidently, being born of water and the Spirit is in. The Holy Spirit's part in that is to supply the word, Luke chapter 8 and verse 11. The seed in the parable of the sower is the word of God, and when the seed is planted in the hearts of good and honest men, it takes root and it bears fruit. Doesn't have to have fertilizer from the Holy Spirit. No direct operation there. All right. In baptism, the person being baptized is anything but passive. He's very active in that process. Remember the Ethiopian nobleman. They're traveling along. He tells Philip, see, here's water. What has hindered me to be baptized? See, he's wanting to respond to the gospel. Philip said, well, you have to believe. And he makes that good confession. I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. They stopped the chariot. They went down in the water, both Philip and the eunuch, and he baptized him. They came up out of the water. The Spirit caught away Philip that he saw him no more. And the Ethiopian eunuch went on his way rejoicing. There's an opportunity for somebody to hear the gospel. Remember, Philip started that passage in Isaiah chapter 53 and preached Jesus. And during the process of preaching Jesus, he had to come across the need to be baptized because that was the Ethiopian's question. He's hearing the message of Jesus. He believes that message. He wants to know what he needs to do. And he says, what? What does hinder me to be baptized? Well, your depraved soul's hindering you to be baptized. Don't you know that? See, Philip didn't answer right, did he? Philip didn't have it right. Philip should have said, well, you can't do anything on your own unless you're one of the elect. In fact, we hope maybe you're one of the elect because we don't know. And if you are one of the elect, then the Holy Spirit has to do something to you. That's that second call you need to wait on and hope you get. Think about how pitiful this doctrine is. You have somebody that hears the gospel, the message, the word. That's that first call that everybody gets to hear. And they say, man, I want that. I want, and they desire to be saved. They're like this Ethiopian. What's holding me back? And they wait. And they wait. And they wait. It may be months, years, decades. It may never come. Now that's an evil doctrine, folks. To offer salvation to everybody. Just to have the door slammed in their face because they weren't one of the elect. How evil is that? But that's their doctrine. That's their doctrine. Everybody gets the call, but not everybody gets the Holy Spirit direct operation because they're not part of the elect. You're just lost. And it doesn't matter if you want to be saved. If you're one of the lost, you're just lost. Then on the other hand, you have somebody that has no desire. What about in Acts chapter 7, where Stephen convicts those unbelieving Jews? He says what? You stiff neck, uncircumcised in heart and ears. You do always resist the Holy Spirit. See, they're resisting the Holy Spirit. You're like your fathers. Now, according to their doctrine, some of those people could have been saved. They could have been some of those elected, because remember, it doesn't matter how you live, what you think, or what you're doing. You could be some of those that gnashed on Stephen with their teeth and still be saved. Never once changing your mind or your position regarding Christ. You just happen to be part of the elect, so you're going to be saved whether you want to or not. On the other hand, if you're not part of the elect, you're never going to be saved, no matter how much you believe in Christ. No matter how much you want to be saved, desire to be saved. You see, that's their position. Irresistible grace changes the order of belief in salvation. Notice a quote from a leading Calvinist. He says, a man is not saved because he believes in Christ. He believes in Christ because he is saved. But the Bible always has faith preceding salvation. Just a few verses, John 3:16, for instance. For God so loved the world. What was the degree of God's love for the world? He so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth on him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Acts 16 and verse 31. And they said, believe on the Lord. Remember, here's the Philippian jailer. What do I need to do to be saved? Great question, right? Calvinists would say, nothing. Just wait around for the Holy Spirit. Too bad Paul didn't understand that. He told him, believe on the Lord, and thou shalt be saved in thy house. Where does faith come in relation to salvation? Before. Mark 16 and verse 15 and 16. Go into all the world. Preach the gospel to every creature. He that believeth and is baptized shall be what? Saved. Every time you see faith and salvation, it's always in that order. Irresistible grace has an erroneous view as to when one is made alive spiritually. Again, Steele and Thomas say, therefore, the Holy Spirit, in order to bring God's elect to salvation, extends to them a special inward calling in addition to the outward calling contained in the gospel message. Through this special call, the Holy Spirit performs a work of grace wherein the sinner, which inevitably brings him to faith in Christ, the inward change wrought in the elect sinner enables him to understand and believe spiritual truth. In the spiritual realm, he is given the seeing eye and the hearing ear. The Spirit creates within him a new heart and a new nature. This is accomplished through regeneration or the new birth, which the sinner is made a child of God and is given spiritual life. His will is renewed through the process so that sinner spontaneously comes to Christ of his own free choice, because he is given a new nature so that he loves righteousness, and because his mind is enlightened so that he understands and believes the biblical gospel, the renewed sinner freely and willingly turns to Christ as Lord and Savior. Thus, the once dead sinner is drawn to Christ by the inward supernatural call of the Spirit, who through regeneration makes him alive and creates within him faith and repentance. Now, while that's what they say, the Bible teaches that one is made alive after hearing and obeying the gospel. Paul states that sinners are buried with him in baptism, wherein also they are risen with him through faith in the operation of God, who has raised him from the dead.
And you being dead in your sins and uncircumcision of your flesh, hath he quickened together with him, having forgiven your trespasses. Colossians chapter 2, verses 12 and 13. You know, Mac talks about this operation of God taking place in the heart of man. And he actually believes that the Holy Spirit changes your heart and makes it receptive. And then it abides in there and helps you after your salvation. Now that's real similar to the conversion process described here by the Calvinists. The scriptures reveal that we are saved by the grace of God, Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 8. However, the sinner is freely given the freedom to choose. We're born with that. You know, if we think about this, like I said, there's a lot of criticism that could go along with this doctrine. And I think one of the greatest criticisms of this doctrine is that it makes God a respecter of persons. Because before the foundation of the world, God predestined certain people to be saved and certain people to be lost. That number's unchangeable. There's nothing that the individual can do if he's saved that he can do to be lost. There's nothing that the lost individual can do to be saved. That number's fixed. It's set. And God's arbitrarily going to save whomsoever he will. That makes God a respecter of persons. But we know that's not the case. We know that God loves everyone in the world. He sent his son to die for all sinners and has given the gospel to everyone to offer them the hope of salvation through obedience to the gospel. That's how God saves us, through grace. His part involves everything that he did on our behalf to save us from our sins. Whether it be coming up with that plan of salvation before he even created the world, when he brought it into effect at the very first sin of Adam and Eve, or whether it was all of the providential care of the line of Christ to the time that he was born and died on the cross and raised the third day. Those are things God did for us, giving us the scripture that tells us of that glorious plan of salvation, that gives us the hope of that salvation through Jesus Christ. Has told us how to access that grace through the obedience of the gospel of Jesus Christ. See, those are things that God's done for us. Our response to that, our belief in Jesus Christ, our repentance from our sins, our obeying the gospel and being baptized for remission of our sins, our living faithful unto death. See, that's our part. God's done his part. So the question is, have we done our part and are we doing it? If not, we have an opportunity while we live to make that change. Remember, it's your choice. The Holy Spirit's not ever going to come and do that for you. You have to do that for yourself. I got a minute or two back that people have been giving up. Thank you.
If the Holy Spirit has been working directly and he says things to be done decently in order and you have a stipulated time period, it would shut him down right then. But his will took over because he has free moral agency even to not abide by the rules. We appreciate that very much. That's a much needed study. We've talked about it around here quite a bit. I think one thing that could be said to just emphasize again what he said right at the last, God does for man what man cannot do for himself. But what man can do, he's always expecting him to do something in response to God's favor that's offered in the gospel message to be able to meet the conditions required of man. Thereby he shows his faith in God and his love of God. There has to be some way for a man to show that. And if you remove his free moral agency, how does he do it? So you have all sorts of choose you this day type statements, who you will serve. And we do make that choice because we have the free will. We might mention this one thing. Most of the churches, denominational churches that we deal with today, are not, we'll put it this way, pure Calvinist. They're modified. If you see on a sign somewhere before a denominational church building, Reformed Presbyterian, Reformed Lutheran, Reformed Baptist, and that's basically where you're going to see them, then you're talking about what he talked about this morning. Back some years ago, there was a great move among those churches that came, claimed Calvin as to being the one that knew the Bible and thus taught the truth in the tulip, as was mentioned. There was a big resurgence, sort of a restoration movement among them to get back to pure Calvinism because it had been basically and still is diluted somewhat. The fellow I debated down here, Bob Ross, is not pure Calvinist. He debates pure Calvinists. You can see in the Baptists too, the old primitive Baptists, they're pure Calvinists. They don't believe that sounding out the gospel is going to call anybody to Jesus Christ, as it was described in the sermon. So you've got those people, and they even debate among themselves. I found it interesting at the end of our debate, and we were loading up things, getting ready to leave out at the car, Bob Ross came up to me and said, do you mind if I use some of your charts when I'm debating the primitive Baptists? I said, go to it. Fine with me. But we had proven that he wasn't at all a whit different from really the claim that the Holy Spirit had to work directly upon the person, because his view is when you preach the gospel, it's the power of God to save. But you still have that Adamic sin that makes you inclined no good thing at all. So the Holy Spirit's got to immediately precede the word to the elect so that they can attend to the word. So we illustrated that by taking in fact, I just reached my pocket and I thought of it and used a ballpoint pen. And this is the arrow head, the sharp part. And the shaft is the word of God. So I just said, what you really believe is, when you preach the word, the Holy Spirit directly is working upon the people out there, just like the arrowhead that's sharp must first penetrate the whoever you're shooting or whatever you're shooting. Then the word slides right on through the hole and is able to do what it does. But you still fundamentally teach just what they do. You just change it. He didn't like that too much. He never did get over it. And nobody can. But that's basically the difference in the pure Reformed Baptist, primitive Baptist, or whatever. They just believe exactly what was said here without re-preaching the sermon. But it's good to know how people are thinking when you go to sit down and try to study with them, if they've been entrenched, indoctrinated in their doctrine. Because sometimes when you're trying to teach them, you don't know why they're saying what they're saying. You need to know where they're coming from so you can better counter that in teaching the truth of the Bible.
The Westminster Confession of Faith was rewritten to soften the total depravity and the election to allow for infants to be saved, mm-hmm. because people were seeing the problem.
Well, really, the whole reason these churches modified it anyway is because they felt the brunt of what we felt this morning when we heard the truth preached, and it was contrasted, that doctrine contrasted with the truth. And you get up like we did in California, pointed out that what this fellow was teaching had little babies, little demons. And we put up a picture. It had a little sweet girl on it with horns on it. And they don't like that, but he couldn't deny it. That's exactly what his doctrine taught. But he didn't want to have to say that and meet it before people.